Yeah. This is actually the Rom Bro theme song.
This is a match up. Usually it's for a sad song, now it's kind of more a beat. I want to say I hate this operation song. It's always started with trash.
In the notes, Martin said unwritten fucking sucks.
I don't like it. Yeah, I've never been a fan.
Oh, that was cool. I like that.
Okay.
When I was 23, I went on a date with this guy, and he was like asking me, what kind of music I liked, and I was just like talking, and then I was like, okay, like what kind of music do you like? And he was like, I only listen to amateur mashups.
He
sent me some of the like mashups he liked, and I was like. I haven't talked to anyone about mashups since high school.
I'm sorry, how old was he?
He was 23? Like 25, maybe. Okay.
Well, that was big back in the day. It was like, you know what? You should look up a mashup real quickly, okay? It's called Snow White Girl. And it's probably
The Disney one.
Dude, this one's really good. This is probably my favorite.
I think I listened to this in high school. I listened to that in high school.
This is like the best mashup. Yeah, this is probably my favorite. Wait for it, Graham.
I'm upset that I know this one.
White girl. Yeah, dude, this is lit. Yeah. Oh, another one. It's really take a Party in the USA and have it with Biggie Smalls. That's a really popular one.
They do the Office theme song with Kanye too. That was a really popular one.
Yeah. I don't know if I heard The Office with Kanye. This way.
No, I don't know if maybe it got taken down or something.
Party and Bullshit in the USA. I think it's superior to Party in the USA. Yeah, it's time for dude. Since the public school era, bathroom passes, cutting classes, yeah, this one. Smoking blunts was a daily routine since 13. A chubby this is probably the best. This song is way much better with this beat behind it. The original version is a little bit slower, but
that's in 2009.
Dude, it was back then, dude. Anyway. This is a whole genre of music that we opened up, and as much as I would love to spend the whole time doing this, I guess we go on.
It's kind of a shame they didn't listen to a mashup in Sister of the Traveling Pants. Were mashups like a little bit after
I think they
were a little before like YouTube, right?
First of all, let's show her a picture of Harley Quinn. That's Harley Quinn, everyone.
The fat ass.
With the huge ass, because I am the Joker. Whoever drew that.
Yeah, nice.
Anyway, I think mashups were popular when that was post-2009. So I think this movie came out 05. I think it was a little bit before it became mainstream.
Yeah,
you know,
no one's listening to mashups of this. If anyone did, I feel like Tibby would be the one.
Tibby, Tabitha is her real name.
Yeah.
Which I think is a very pretty name. I think she would go by Tabitha, you know.
Ron Bros, this week we watched The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
Yes.
What did you think? What were your initial thoughts? Had you seen it before?
I'd not
seen it before.
I've heard it before. Like I said previously, I've had my own type of brotherhood with the Jester thong, which I can't find anywhere. I cannot find any thong that looks like that. It was
bummer.
I saw it. What?
A bummer.
Yeah, I know. I don't know what happened to it. Anyway, yeah, it's my first time. It was okay. It wasn't spectacular, you know. It is what it is, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I wasn't like, oh, this is the greatest thing. But I wasn't like, it didn't like full. It was just like, this is a movie, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This is a movie for preteen girls.
Did you have a favorite member of the Sisterhood?
Who do I like? I don't know. Hard to say. I mean, I guess Bridget, it's cool, right?
Yeah, I was going to say, I feel like Bridget is the cool
she's
girl.
She's a cool one. Yeah. Then, what's the name of the girl who goes to South Carolina?
Carmen.
Carmen. I think she's probably really fun to hang out with, really easy to be a friend with.
Yeah, who do you think had the biggest problem in their life?
Probably Carmen.
I think Bridget did too.
Oh yeah, so the Bridget story starts before the summer.
Yeah,
because Bridget's mom kills herself.
Yeah,
she commits suicide. Yeah, suicide. That's heavy. How the movie opens up. Yeah,
it's really heavy. Yeah.
Yeah. And then I think it really impacts her life. I don't think her. There's actually, I said this in the notes. These girls do not have any positive male role models in this movie.
Fun fact, that the person who plays Bridget's father in this movie is Blake Lively's father in real life, Ernie
cool.
Lively.
Did you know the person who plays Carmen's father? Was in Billy Madison and The West Wing.
Oh, yeah, I didn't know that.
The first guy was in The West Wing and Billy Madison. And I guess, so Blake Lively is Bridget. And actually, if you don't know, Blake Lively comes from like an acting family. Yeah. All their siblings are actors. So, I guess I didn't like, honestly, I didn't recognize that was Blake Lively. I didn't know that was her to like the credits. So, yeah, I guess shame on me. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, she's like a little younger. Obviously, this is like 2005.
Yeah, I never watched the OG Gossip Girl.
Yeah, I read the book, The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants books, too, in addition.
There's like five.
There's like four, I think.
Okay, four
or maybe
five.
Yeah.
There's more than one. They only made two movies of these.
Yeah, they combine the second movie is kind of like multiple books combined into one, and they do a couple like time.
Yeah, I think I read
not like big time skips, but like, oh, it's fall, now it's next summer.
But this these movies are set actually in Bethesda, Maryland, everyone.
They really made Bethesda seem like a small town, but
yeah, there's no mention of DC being close by.
I guess anywhere is a small town though if you don't have a car.
Yeah, I guess. So. But there's no mention like there's nowhere in DC. It's just like we're in Bethesda, Maryland. And
yeah, it's just like
if you're not from the area, you have to look it up. Like, oh, this is. But anyway, only one of these girls stays in Bethesda for the summer. Before everyone leaves, they go to this store and find some jeans.
They go to like a thrift store.
Yeah, yeah. And the jeans that
magically fit all of them.
Yeah, miraculously, they all fit. You know, because there's not, you know, everyone's different size people. There's not an ideal size for anybody.
It's kind of funny, though, because they act like they're like, how can it, like, a pair of pants fit you and me? And they're all pretty close to the same size. Like,
yeah, I mean, I think which the only one
in the book, it makes a little, like, Carmen's a little curvier. But in the movie, like, they're all very close.
The only one would be Carmen, but I think maybe the jeans wouldn't fit. But the other 30 can wear, all pretty.
It's like, that's actually not insane.
Yeah, there's not too many.
But they're like, yeah, it's so crazy. Yeah, and it's like, I mean,
yeah, I would agree that
it's really not, but
these girls are dumb, guys. That's what we're saying.
But yeah, they find a pair of pants and they decide that they're magical because they fit all of them. And then they decide that in their summer apart, the pants are what will keep them together, that each person will take it for a week and then mail it. They have, like, rules for the pants.
Yeah. There's like 15 rules or something.
Yeah.
I don't know if they went over each one. I mean, they went over a few, but I don't know if they went over all, like, 15. Did they?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't remember.
They're
that.
Like,
you could probably find the rules. Oh, damn. Here. We the Sisterhood must, like, first of all, must never wash that. I feel like somebody washed them, right? You must never double cuff the pants. It's tacky. You must never say the word fat while wearing the. I remember that being said at the movie. Must never let a boy take off your pants.
Rule number four is a little different in the books. They say, like, you must never let a boy take off your pants, but you can remove them, like,
oh, you
in
can
his
take
presence.
Them off. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You must let pick your nose, of course. What someone say? You must follow proper procedures for documenting. Must write your sisters throughout the summer. Must pass the pants. Well, this only has 9. Must wear the pants in a tucked-in shirt and belt. Oh, not wear your pants. Good. I was like, lame. Oh, and remember, pants equal love. Love your pals. Love yourself.
Yeah.
I feel like rule number 10 is the most important. This is number 10. Anyway, so everyone leaves except for Tippy.
Who's working at the, like,
it's not Walmart, but it's like
called Walmans. It's it kind of looks like Walgreens.
Yeah.
And she's working on her, like, documentary.
It's a documentary about plain folk in Bethesda, Maryland. The plain folk, simple living here in Bethesda.
In a zip code of the highest cost of living in the United States.
Yeah.
But we're just going to go talk to
the easygoing people who work retail. But so she stays, and then Carmen goes to Charleston, South Carolina to visit her father, and she goes by train. And actually, I related to this
because
she basically takes a train to DC to Charleston. I did that one Thanksgiving. It's my dad's from Charleston, so I'm going to see my grandma. That train ride is like 14 hours, okay? And it's excruciating. That was the worst trip of my life.
Do they give you meals? Is there like a cafeteria?
There's like a food cart or whatever, but still 14 hours on a trip. Literally, I was like, I will always pay whatever for it.
Did your whole family do it?
No, because I live up here, so my dad and mom usually drive down.
Okay, and so you had to take the train?
Yeah, because that year in particular, like, their lives were, like, super expensive that Thanksgiving. So I was like, yeah, I'll take the train. I've never done that before. And it's supposed to be, like, 12 hours, but it ended up being 14.
Did you see anything cool? Did you go by anything?
No, like, you know where trains go by? Like, fucking nowhere.
Yeah, like abandoned train.
Yeah, you go to fucking
bone. Yeah, abandoned train down.
Yeah, you go to bone fuck. And actually, a lot of trains are actually, like, prisons. So if you're driving by, you see, like prisoners, like, playing basketball or something. Oh. Yeah, it's like, it's...
Dang.
Yeah, it just goes to, like, bone fuck, nowhere, America. And anyway... She would have arrived just exhausted and
yeah
and the Wi-Fi.
You can take Amtrak from DC straight to my hometown. It was an old train town.
Yeah,
yeah.
How long is
I
that,
took it
though?
One time. It was again one of the worst.
Yeah, it's yeah.
It was horrible.
Yeah,
I've also taken a train from North Carolina to Florida, and that was fresh hell.
Was that 14 hours?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like.
It's horrible.
See, the worst part is, like, you can do long trains like that, and you could get, like, a room or something to, like, sleep in, but this was not an option on the train.
It's always worth it to pay double or triple to take a plane.
Yeah, just due to the plane, I've never... drive.
But yeah, Carmen looks pretty fresh as a daisy when she gets off this train.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
not realistic.
Trust me, I was like in tears.
I don't know anyone who feels good after they get off the Amtrak.
Dude, I was like crying, like, I've made it. I just want to go to bed. I don't want to. I'll never take a train that's more than 4 hours. So I'll take the train in New York, but anything beyond that.
Even the train in New York, it's like not bad, but yeah, like she like wants to like play tennis after like going on her train. I'm like, I don't want to play tennis after getting off a train.
Yeah,
I don't want to do shit.
She
goes to Charleston to visit her dad.
And her dad has a surprise for everyone.
Yeah, he like has a surprise for her. Yeah. And it's basically that he has a whole new family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's engaged. He's engaged. And now he lives with his fiance and their two stepchildren.
Yeah.
And that's his surprise.
He's got a whole ass other family. Yeah. And
he's like the worst dad.
He's a pretty bad dad, yeah, and he's basically, like, being these kids' dad and barely visits her.
He really neglects Carmen.
Yeah, and they're like, surprise, like, you're going to be a bridesmaid in the wedding.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah.
And then, her dad just, like, never gives her the time. Then by the end of it, she gets really mad. So they try on the bridesmaid's dress. And, before we get there, the woman this guy is marrying, we're pretty sure she's racist. We're pretty sure she's probably racist. Right, Jenny?
I mean, they have, like, a Spanish-speaking housekeeper. And the mom basically tells her not to speak in Spanish to the housekeeper.
The kids didn't even know what Spanish was. Because Carmen is like Puerto Rican.
Yeah, Carmen's Puerto Rican. And she's obviously like talking to the housekeeper. She's fluent in Spanish.
Yeah. And the kids are like, is that Spanish she's talking?
Yeah.
And it's like, even if like you don't know Spanish, I think you know how Spanish sounds like. These are like middle school age kids.
No, they're
like,
in high school.
Even worse, you would know what Spanish sounds like.
Yeah, that was all like a little cringy. And
You could. I'm saying this woman's party race.
Yeah, so. And the trying on the bridesmaid dress was like pretty bad. The dress, first of all, doesn't fit. It's way too small. And her soon-to-be stepmother is like telling the person working there, like, I'm so sorry, I didn't realize her father would be so off when like guessing her size. And she's like, can we just get some more fabric here? And she basically like feels like unattractive and made to feel bad about her appearance. So this all culminates with her kind of getting mad. She comes home and is looking in the window of the house and sees them all eating dinner together like a perfect family, and she ends up like throwing a rock.
Yeah, and so she runs away out of the dress store. No one, I guess, cares where she went to.
Yeah.
And then she comes back, throws a rock through the window, breaking it. Her dad's like right next to the window. just looks over, doesn't react, and she runs away again to the train station and take a 14-hour train back to Bethesda. But her dad does nothing. He doesn't, like, first of all, I mean, yeah, I don't know. I thought he'd run after her, but she also breaks a fucking window. I think he'd be like, hey, don't break windows. Or he doesn't do anything, so it makes sense why she doesn't want to go to his stupid wedding. Like, it doesn't seem... He's not doing anything.
She's wearing the pants, right, at this point?
What?
Is she wearing the pants?
No.
Oh, okay. This is before the pants.
Yeah.
So it's just like, so her dad...
Yeah.
It just seems like he really doesn't care. I don't know.
Yeah. No, just like, he's just kind of a...
Dude, he's
a shitty parent without being like criminal, you know. He's
a cuck, dude.
I don't really think he's a cuck, Martin.
Saying like he's a cuck because she has a husband and then who's in jail, but they don't explain why he's in jail.
They say he's in jail or something.
They
say he's in prison, I think. He is also an alcoholic.
That puts you in prison, guys.
Yeah, so it didn't really explain what he did, but
So Carly goes back. Okay, next story. Who do you want to do next?
Let's do Lena.
Lena has the best story. It's not that.
Has probably the best summer.
Yeah,
I'd say
the best experience, best story. She goes to Greece.
She's Greek. Her grandparents still live in Greece.
Yeah, old country.
Yeah, she goes to Greece to like reconnect with her like roots.
Yeah,
and stuff.
Yeah.
She's very American. She doesn't like really speak Greek very well.
No.
So she goes to visit her grandparents. Greek. And honestly, like the second she fucking gets there, she meets a hot guy.
Yeah,
falls into.
The ocean
in
Mediterranean.
Yeah, like the sea in the jeans, and then they get caught on something, and so she's stuck.
The jeans almost kill her.
Yeah, and then a hot guy dives in and rescues her.
The jeans brought the hot guy.
Yeah,
who's like who? Also, Australia, America, but his parents died. So he comes back to...
He's Greek, but he was in America until he was a little kid. He was in the U.S. until he was a little kid and his parents died.
He comes back, but...
He comes back to live with his grandparents.
But he still goes to school in the U.S.
I thought he went in the U.K.
He's not going in Greece. That's the point. He doesn't live in Greece either, but he's there...
Yeah.
He works the docks, the fisherman.
Yeah, he's a fisherman. Yeah, fisherman. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
She pretty immediately starts kind of hanging with him.
She's kind of has been up for her. I guess she's has been after she tells her
She tells her grandmother about it, and her grandmother's like, oh, Costas, like...
Yeah, that's... We hate that family.
We hate that family.
They're cheaters. They're rats. They're no good.
They got like major fish drama.
Yeah. They're like competition or something.
Yeah.
But, at first, Lena is hesitant.
Yeah.
But then she just gives
pretty
in.
Pretty quickly.
She's secretly
sneaking around with
seeing this hot guy. And then, I think her grandparents, her grandma, and aunts and cousins or whatever find out about it and are pretty mad. But then,
she convinces them that she really loves him.
It was her grandfather who doesn't speak much, who keeps to himself, that she opens up to and says, confesses her love. And he's like, he's never spoken in barely any words. He was like, go
to the docks. Yeah.
So a lot of movies have that scene where you're under the airport, like, oh, I gotta stop the plane. This movie has where it's like, I gotta stop the boat. I gotta get off the boat before he goes.
And then she like tells him that she loves him before he leaves.
Yep. And then she comes back like super great. She has like black hair. It's all, it's really stylish. She's wearing Greek attire.
Yeah.
Hey,
Bridget.
So Bridget has the juiciest story.
Yeah, she really has the juiciest story. She goes to soccer camp in Mexico. She is
she's like an elite soccer player.
Yeah, she's like a 5-star recruit. Yeah.
She's gonna play in college.
Yeah, she's definitely getting recruited by like Division I schools. She goes to this like elite soccer camp in Mexico, and she was really excited to go, and then she found out that the camp was all girls. She's less excited.
Right? It's like Boy Scout camp. Why is there so much guys at Boy Scout camp? Okay.
She shows up at camp, and pretty immediately there's a hot guy on staff.
But he plays in Columbia. Or he goes to Columbia.
Yeah, plays soccer in college. For Columbia, so he's like a counselor.
So she's 17.
He's probably 20. He's not older than 20.
Yeah. At most, he's 20. Yeah. So I appreciate it really.
It's not good, but it's not like, I don't know.
It's not like terrible.
He's not like a coach of a school or something.
Yeah, he's not like a man in his 30s or 40s. Yeah.
So
like they went to high school together, but I mean they could have gone to high school together.
Yeah, it's not horrible. It's that storyline might not have aged as well. She pretty immediately is like kind of throwing herself at him.
Shows off a lot.
She's like pouring water on her sweaty her hair.
She does it very provocatively on purpose.
She pulls out all the stops, and then she ends up like making it known that she's like going like for a walk on the beach one night, and then she basically fucks him.
He sees her. They go to that bar. The same night?
I think it's the same night.
They go to a bar. They dance, and they do it, baby, on the beach. So she's only 17. Yeah, you know, a lot of people have that fantasy sleeping with a hot camp counselor.
Yeah.
And she did it, so.
She comes back super depressed.
She doesn't have, like, her relationship with her father, I don't think it's too good either. It's like, doesn't he send her a letter again, but it's like two sentences.
Yeah, yes. I think that they haven't really processed her mother's death.
That's fair. We don't. But how long has it been since this?
I think it's been a couple of years. They didn't exactly hire younger actresses to play them at the funeral. So
that's true.
Yeah, I think it's only been a few years, probably. So they don't really seem to. Have processed or really gotten any help. they're a classic example of like, wow, they need therapy, like, so they can talk to each other. She's got good friends. Her friends, like, she's super depressed, and her
friends are like, you're totally not gonna kill yourself, like your mom.
God, Martin.
That's basically what they said.
You can tell this is like early 2000s with the way they talk about it. That was like one note I had, was like the way they talk about like her mother's suicide. They're kind of like, well, you're not like your mom, like you're strong, and your mom,
you,
like,
wouldn't kill yourself.
Your mom wasn't able to like be as strong as you. So like they're not talking about it in the best way, but they clearly mean well. They care about her. That's kind of her summer.
Tibby, Tabitha, she's doing the documentary. She's working on a story, and there's some little girl who faints in the aisle. So she calls 911, the ambulance, and they take the little girl away. And the next day, the little girl like shows up at her house. The girl's like 10 or something. I don't know, 12. Yeah. I think she says she was 12.
She's 12. Yeah.
Yeah, and then she was like, "Oh, I want to be your documentary assistant." So then they do this documentary about the small town people in Bethesda. And then one day, the little girl doesn't show up. And Timmy's like, you know, she's got attached to her. She likes, at first she was annoyed, but now she, you know, has this friendship. And we find out the reason why she fainted. She has leukemia. She has childhood leukemia, everybody. Childhood leukemia. So, and guess what, everyone? Doesn't make it. Does not make it. She dies. You never see the little girl's parents. She's pretty independent for a 12-year-old.
Yeah, they clearly didn't want to hire anyone to be your parents. So.
For a 12-year-old with leukemia. So anyway, she dies, but she dedicated, she finished the documentary and names it after the girl. What's her name again?
Bailey.
Bailey.
Yeah. Tibby's whole kind of thing is kind of complicated by the fact that her parents had her pretty young. Oh, and right, then yeah. like 15 years later had two more kids. So she's kind of like.
Her parents are busy with a kid.
With her little siblings. Yeah. Her like two.
Yeah.
And
babysit.
Yeah. So she has to like babysit and kind of do that. And yeah. So. Yeah.
So anyway, but by now, everyone's back. I think. Was it Carmen and Bridget who reaches out? Like, I need to hear from you guys. Or.
Yeah, they like
reconnect.
They reconnect.
And then I think Lena was the last one to come back. And
they all go with Carmen to her dad's wedding.
They
drive to Charleston this time.
7-8 hours.
They did actually show it taking a long time.
It would take long.
Then Carmen wears the pants to her dad's wedding, which is an odd choice.
Which she's not in the wedding. I don't know if they know.
She's not in the wedding anymore, but then he pulls her up to stand with them. And she's wearing jeans.
He was like, I can't go through. I need my daughter up here.
Yeah.
Then he like says this whole nice speech about her in front of her, even though he acted so shitty. And then she stands at the altar, everybody, except she's wearing the jeans. While we once wear the dress. It really stood out. And I was like, oh, this is kind of embarrassing. But
yeah.
Anyway. And now, yeah, the pants did all that, guys.
The pants brought everyone together.
And before they leave, Bridget, dog, takes the pants, runs outside of the house. She chases her dog. And guess who she runs into? The camp counselor, the client.
Who's just driven to Bethesda to talk to her.
Yeah, yeah. On his way back to college. So, to be fair, maybe Bethesda's.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But, yeah, he's just, like, kind of wandering because there's a Hobart place and a Hobart street or something like that. Which
he finds it.
Her dress is a little confusing. And then he's just wandering around and then he finds her and talks to her.
He's wandering
he's basically like, I feel bad about what happened. And she's like, it's my fault. And he's like, call me in a few years.
Yeah. He's like, hit me up. You're a soccer star.
Yeah,
so I guess it's, I don't know. But does he come back in the second one or any of the books?
I don't remember. I don't think so. I think.
Dude, we need it right.
She has like her own, like she does some other like cool shit in the other books. So she kind of, I think.
Yeah, a affair with a married man.
No. She like goes abroad and does like interesting stuff. I don't remember him. So I think she kind of.
We gotta write the next book. We gotta bring him back.
Yeah.
After all these years, he comes back. It's like, I'll never forget you. But.
Yeah, Lena has another love interest later.
Is that the Greek guy?
Yeah, she has a new love interest that gets introduced.
Is he Greek or? No. Oh, okay. No, actually, the actress is actually Argentinian. She's not Greek at all.
Yeah.
So they could have just did it in Argentina. I think that could have been cool. But, Blake Lively, her character likes older guys, and she likes older guys because she married Ryan Reynolds, who's like 8 or 9 years older than her. So really, you know, really is art become imitates life.
Art imitates life. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, there was, when I worked at camp, I guess, I don't know anybody who hooked up with a participant. I was never heard of that before, but there was a guy who was 17 and who worked there as a counselor, who hooked up with another counselor who was almost 23, and that guy is the coolest guy I know. That guy had just finished his junior year of high school, and I'm sure he came back as the king. And anyway, the point is that guy, the problem with that is he peaked too early because he was doing all this stuff, you know, when he was 17, 18. And then he got into college, joined the frat, flunked out, became alcoholic, like gained like 50 pounds.
Bummer.
So yeah, I'm saying you shouldn't, like stuff like that shouldn't be happening because it's just too much to handle.
Right, were you at camp when that happened?
When he gained all that weight, you know.
No, when he hooked up with her.
Yeah, there was that. Yeah, this one, I knew that she was love of my life. I had a little skin. No.
Oh, no.
No, that's a girl I wrote like that, like 12-page letter to. And I was like, I need someone to talk to. Here it is, me bleeding.
What was your age difference? Was she your age?
Yeah, she was like my age. I was like,
that's good.
But he had a separate thing with my friend Erica, which she doesn't care if I say it. It's cool, I swear. But the funny story is, this one time we were staying in this apartment, and it was a one-bedroom apartment, and she's in bed with this guy. You know, other friend on this couch, you know, in the living room. And the problem with the apartment was there's one bathroom, and it was in the bedroom. So I had to be like, I gotta go. So I had to like knock on the door and be like, sorry, I gotta go potty. I'm so sorry.
Oh no, Martin.
So, yeah, I was like, sorry, I really have to go.
All right, Martin, would you say this movie was romantic?
There are parts of it. I mean, not every one story.
Yeah.
At least Leap and Lena is the most traditional tale. Everybody, I mean, you know, Tibby isn't really nothing about it. I guess she might be dating the video game guy.
Yeah, they all end up having romances at some point in the series.
Yeah.
But, so not everyone did in the first book.
Yeah. But. And, you know, Bridget, not the best story, probably.
Right,
Justin looked back on it fondly. I mean, Cartman does really have a love story.
Do you want to summarize in a minute?
No, I gotta do it. Okay.
Yeah.
Did I do it loud? I can't really. Okay.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, go.
Okay, it's these four girls find pants. They're all fit though, and so it's get the magical. They're all leaving for the summer. One goes to Greece, finds a hot guy her family hates, but they come around and let her go, and she falls to him. The other one goes to South Carolina to see her father, finds out he's getting married and has stepkids, and she gets really mad and leaves. And then the other one goes to Sark again, hooks up with an older counselor. And then the last one stays in town, does a documentary, befriends a little dying girl, and she dies. And then they all come back together, and then they go to the girl's wedding in South Carolina, and her dad accepts her, and the camp counselor says, hey, wait for me, and they all have a great time in summer, and it's all set in Bethesda, Maryland, and that's it. The pants worked, I guess.
Nice.
But,
yeah. All right, well.
Yeah. That 17-year-old, he did everything I wanted to do, you know?
Like, yeah.
He's like 20, like something else.
He must have written a really good letter.
Yeah. I didn't, though. It was just me rambling. Because I think I just needed someone to talk. I needed a therapist.
Sounds like you're treating it like a journal entry.
Yeah. But, you know, it's all good, guys.
Well,
look at me now. Look at us.
Ron Bros, you can write in and tell us your summer camp romance.
Yeah, that's right. I think I'm sweating a lot here. Sorry if that looks so wet. But yeah, it's summer, everyone. This was a great summer movie.
Great summer movie.
Yeah.
Tell us about your summer romance, yeah. Ron Bros.
Yeah, let us know.
Let us know.
That's it. Okay, bye. See ya. Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I had my piece. Sure do. 222s in my shoes. Holla if you need me, love. I'm in the house. Roman Strode. See what the honey's in.